Welcome back, guys. Going into the third hour here and about to make some fun rolls. Let me unmute the cast. So I think it's a 14 or a 15% chance on each roll that we don't make it.
So you need to get a 7 or better on 2d6 plus whatever your modifier is for navigation.
Which is a 0.
Okay.
That's 50%, isn't it?
7 on a plus 0, 7 is.
I don't know where they got the 15% chance from.
Around the middle.
I do need to roll pretty well, though.
So, do you go immediately from taking your pants off to drinking to hitting the button?
I take all the shots, and I guess, like, as I'm just sitting there, I've got both hands on the nav panel, like, leaned forward with my head kind of tilted down, looking at the button ready to press it, and I come back, and I'm like, Pop, can you please activate all emergency noises and things so that if this does go sour and people might come find us?
Yeah, Pi activates the emergency beacon.
So now it's just like me standing there with these sirens going off all around me. I just like look down at the button. I'm just like, Pi, it's been a pleasure. Here we go. 8.
Boom.
Nice. Okay. All right. 6. So you plan the last jump. Once you realize that you're in the drive space, like you've made the jump, you then have 6 days basically alone on the ship before you arrive in Tovar. So,
oh my God, massive masturbation session.
What's Higgs' lonely voyage like? What do you do for a week?
Don't breathe heavily, Higgs. You've actually only got 5 days of life support, so...
That's like one thought in my head right now. I see the face of Victor kind of like floating. He's like, don't breathe heavily. And then I see like my face, and it's like, you want to drink all that liquor, don't you? I'm just like, yes. Yes, I do. And so it's basically just nonstop drinking with like country music at the loudest it's possibly been. I turn off all of the sirens. I talk to Pi about life and the philosophy of what it is to be alive while I'm really drunk. That's like super drunk, Higgs.
Great.
And I ask him who his favorites are on the ship. Does he give me a response?
Yeah, I mean, Pi has a communication. Like, they're happy to talk to you as long as you're conscious and capable of communicating.
Yeah.
I think that Pi, like, isn't developed enough, really, to have, like, a favorite. Like, they're pretty attached to Piani because they see Piani as being responsible for getting them where they are now.
I'll talk to Pi as my Twitch chat sometimes talks to me. And I say, Pi, and I put up a picture of Piani, and I put 1-10 question mark.
Awesome. Okay, so you're trying to get Pi to like rank the crew members?
Yeah, I mean, I've got 6 days to kill.
Yeah, sure, you're pretty bored. Yeah, Pi definitely puts Piani at the top. Probably then everybody else within a fairly like close assessment underneath, but you don't get the impression that Pi has thought about this a lot. Like it takes a couple of days maybe for them to process and make this decision.
Okay.
A 14 charisma, Pi.
it's based primarily on who's talked to Pi directly the most.
Damn it. I smoke all the cigs and the entire like all that shit. I finish all of the alcohol. And, like, I guess on the final day, I'm just sitting there completely fucking naked, sitting in the chair, the captain's chair, just, like, slouched and just waiting, like, counting every second to get closer and closer to Tovar.
Okay.
And then as we get closer, I guess I'm just like, Pi, you're going to have to land this thing. Can you do that?
Pi is totally capable and aware of how to manage the ship once you guys are out. When you say that, Pi comes back with, pilot the ship before or after I kill you?
I put a question mark.
It just Pi plays back the audio track of you being like, if this doesn't go well, like, you gotta kill me. Don't let me suffocate.
Oh, Pi, this is going fabulous. There's no need to kill me. You can...
Pi points out that you're one day of life support shy of getting there intact.
Pi, delete the directive to kill Higgs.
Okay. You see, like, kill Higgs. It's on, like, a to-do list. It's like, kill Higgs.
Strike that from the record, good Sir Pi. Or Madame.
Okay. Yeah, so Pi asks you, what do I do?
What do you mean? You land the ship.
Where?
Well, I need to talk to some people at Tovar, so why don't we get... why don't we get right above the planet and then, like, you know, a couple in the orbit, to use a word you probably would understand better. We'll get in orbit of the planet and then I will contact Tovar and make sure we can land in some.
So while you're talking, Pi brings up a hologram display of Tovar with some basic information about the planet. So Tovar is the system, its only habitated planet is Elohaba. It's a tech level 3 silicate mining planet.
Have I ever been there?
No. Well, maybe. I don't know. You've been all over the place. If you want to have been there, sure. But
I don't know if it will benefit me if I've been there. But
yeah, well, that's what your culture roles are for, right? If you want to, like, meet someone there and know someone.
Yeah, I guess I will make a culture role just to see who I know.
Okay.
Would it be culture criminal or culture world? Or do I just choose?
Well, your world skill is only ACES, so you're going to use criminal.
And then do I add my charisma to that?
In this case, you would add intelligence because you're recalling information.
Okay, so I'm just going to roll plus one because I don't have any intelligence. Okay. 8.
Okay. Yeah, so the planet, you're still pretty jammed in the corner, right, of the sector. Tech level 3 planet is like 21st century technology, maybe. Like, they got cars and like chemical rockets and stuff. Okay. But like Elohaba will not have the medical equipment required to.
But they're going to have fuel and stuff, right?
Maybe like refined hydrogen fuel. Like the your best bet is that in the system there's an exchange, an exchange station that'll be able to pick you up. Elohaba itself won't. They won't be able to help you.
Okay. Well, I guess when he pulls up all that information, I just like I do the minority report and just swipe that off. I'm like, I ask him if there's any refueling. I'm just like, Pi, refueling stations, is there any in the area? Do you have a list of those?
Yeah, Pi brings up a report for a station, station TVL-434. It's, again, shitty backwater exchange station. It's sort of neutral space. It's in a, like, Lagrange point between the gas giant and the sun. And it's primarily used for... like exchange courier ships stopping and picking stuff up. You couldn't just like pull up and be like, hey, fuel us up, but they will have fuel there, so they might be able to help you.
Yeah, I say, Pi, let's go there for now. We'll go to that and we'll get some fuel. Let's do that. I'm going to go make sure that I like pull up the life support tab or whatever.
Yep.
And what does it show? Does it just show like 10%?
Zero, 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 zero.
Yeah, you're running pretty low. Like this is like maybe the last day that you have like full life support. There's gonna be a day where you're gonna have to sit real still and breathe real slow and hope you don't freeze to death.
Does the refueling station not have life support stuff?
It does. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, that's where I want to go. It's to that. And since now I see that it's like super low, I just and I just barely move. I stay in the entire position.
Okay.
At the same position.
You're going to be conscious. You can seal the like med bay and focus all of the air life support there. Do you want to do anything else to prepare? Because life support isn't just air, right? Life support is like pressure and gravity.
Heat
is a big one.
Can I play FTL with the ship and like open up? Or not open up, but turn everything off except for the bridge and the life support stuff?
The
med bay or wherever they're at?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's what I do. I just like...
The bare necessities, you could say.
Yeah. I basically section off the entire ship.
Okay.
Except for the bridge and the life support.
Yeah, and like a day out, the ship starts to warn you. Like, it's like, life support systems, minimal. Estimated amount of time, 26 hours. And it's like dropping, and you can see like the temperature gauges start to run. It's like giving you heads up displays of like all of the bad shit that's happening on the ship. And you actually notice, like, once the ship starts telling you, like, your breath is sort of misting a little bit.
Okay. I pull up the thing that says like distance to refueling station.
It's gonna be a full day to get to Tovar, and then up to 48 hours before you arrive at the station.
So 3 days?
Could be, yeah. Depending on when you hit the edge of the station and where, or the edge of the system and where in the orbit the station is.
You would die.
Yeah.
Victor Kovacs' brain is screaming, "We are so fucked."
So like,
but you went to sleep so peacefully, you've got a smile on your body.
Yeah. I'm just like super relaxed.
Adam Higgs, being Higgs, brings up the distance to that. And then by comparison on the other side brings up the life support and just stares at the two. What are the two times next to each other?
There's definitely longer travel time than there is life support. You could aim for Tovar and hope that you safely crash land because the planet's temperate. But the longer you stay in space, the more likely it is you're going to freeze. Everyone else will be more likely to be okay because they're in sort of suspended animation.
If we get to the, do I know enough? If we like land on the planet, that we're all going to be okay. The ship's just going to be in shit.
I mean, it depends on where you land and who finds you and all that shit, right?
I guess by what I'm saying or what I'm trying to say is like, is life support just having like air, or are they? Do they have something else that's keeping them alive medically?
No, they're not. They're not like medically supported by any devices. They're just they're basically just bodies. Okay. Their body temperature is really low. They're in sort of semi-suspended animation.
Okay. And then did we determine, does Mr. S's suit have life support or anything like that? It doesn't, right?
It's like six hours. But I think you also have vac suits on the ship, don't you?
Yeah, your vac suits.
Yeah, four.
Okay, well, I guess if possible, I tell Pi, I'm like, Pi, we're going to land on Tovar, and it's going to be the quickest and dirtiest landing that you can make. The objective is to land as fast as possible without crashing the ship and killing everyone else in it. Does that make, do you understand?
I seems to understand, yep.
Okay. I say that, and I like punch in whatever coordinates I need to, and then I go get in the one of the vac suits, and then if I can, I also put the three of them in a vac suit.
Okay.
Is that possible?
It's awkward and takes a lot of work, but you could do it. While you're like vac suiting them up, it also occurs to you that you could probably jury rig like a chained support system out of several vac suits so that you'd have more time.
I mean, it's no, like I want to. I'd rather keep the
human centipede of vac suits.
I'd rather keep the. Oh, but you're saying we have more than four? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
I don't know how many vac suits you guys have on the ship.
30.
Four. 30.
How many do we have, Victor?
Four.
I think it's four.
I have four.
I think it's four.
Okay.
I have 30, but that's fine. We'll do it four.
I put the three of them in one, and I put myself in one as well to buy us more time.
I don't know if all three of them will fit in one vac suit, but that sounds good.
The three in each.
I know. Yeah.
That's the teacher thing. Like, can I use the bathroom? He's like, I don't know.
I also don't turn it on. I don't turn it on until there's 2 hours left of life support on the ship.
Okay.
So I don't turn them on immediately. I just make sure they're all inside of it. And then I go back to the bridge and pull up the time to land and see how long it says.
All right, yeah, I mean, it's ticking down. It's going to be a close one. So you get all suited up, life support dwindling. You start to feel kind of lightheaded. You're, like, cold, but you have the vac suit on, so it's helping. You come out of drive space, and you can see the tiny dot of Tovar, of the star, off in the distance as your sub drive engines like push you towards it at as fast as they can go. So if you want to remain conscious to Tovar, I need you to make a physical effect save.
Okay. Physical effects, d20. Do I get any bonuses on this or just flat
no.
d20? So yeah, 16 so or this is a 16 or higher.
16 or higher, yep. Okay. All right.
And you're out.
Yeah, so you pass, you lose consciousness as you pass by on the left. You can see out the viewport some like massive gas giant passing by, and you can see ice crystals on the inside of your vac suit.
Yeah.
And you just start to like lose consciousness. and you can see sort of blurrily, like, on the HUD, Pi trying to, like, message you something, and maybe you go to respond, but your hands are all numb, and you kind of end up just putting your head down on the terminal for a little bit.
Should I kill you?
Because, you know, you'll be fine. You'll be fine if you just put your head down,
the forehead
close your
just
eyes,
bumps just the, like, Y take, button.
Just take a deep breath, you'll be okay, and then everything just kind of goes dark, and you start to feel warm and, like, comfortable, and and so you are asleep. You wake up sometime later. You are not wearing the vac suit. In fact, you're like wet, and you can hear, like, this loud like screeching noise coming from somewhere.
Just like that.
That's incredible.
Thanks, Griffin. That was well timed. Good job. I'm like,
you're
co-GM.
A really good DM. Yeah, exactly.
That was awesome. And you hear this, like, shrieking from somewhere far away, and you think you hear voices, but your vision is all blurry, and you don't know what's going on. You feel like something is, like, moving you. What are you gonna do?
I guess I just react as, like, quickly and stupidly as possible. If he reaches for
the alcohol bottle next to him, he's like.
Actually, yeah, no, you know, you're right. Hold on. Jeff brings up a great point. I've been in this very same situation a billion and one times. I woke up, not realizing that I passed out, not knowing where I'm at, hearing completely strange noises and sounds. And so I just, like, slowly reach for something, probably the bottle, and uncork it, and I kind of open one eye to make sure that I can still see.
So when you move your arm, you feel like someone, like, grab your arm and, like, hold it down, and there's more talking, and it's like you can sort of start to hear words, but they're not in a language you understand, and so someone is holding you down, maybe more than one person. Then again, your vision is still all blurry, and it's kind of like fading in and out a little bit.
It's the Monty Python nunnery castle where they're like, "You must spank all of us."
Yeah.
Yep. I just try to be wide awake at a moment. Like, once I realize what's kind of happening and what happened to me, that I wasn't drunk, I passed out in space.
Mm-hmm.
And I just kind of, like, stand up abruptly, or try to if I'm being held down.
Okay. You're held down. You hear the first like voice that is in a language you understand, or like comes through the haze of being unconscious as long as you were, and someone is like, "Oh, calm down. You're very hurt. Don't move. Don't move. Please, there was a crash. Just be still."
What? Where am I? What is this? Is this Tovar?
It's Victor. You're in hell. Or the Vincent or whatever.
It's Randy.
You got some explainings to do.
Is this Tovar?
The horrible burning skull. So the voice is like, yes, this is Tovar. Just don't move. Don't move.
My four friends. Are they okay? Three friends. Four, there's four bodies somewhere. Are they alive?
So the person, and you can start to see vaguely above you. Your vision is starting to clear a little bit. You can see like a bright light and heat coming from somewhere nearby. There are three or four people around you. They're all talking to each other and it's language you understand. Someone is leaning over you. And this person, they have a, like, a deep voice, like a man's voice, and they're like, "Just hold still. You'll be fine. We're getting your friends out now."
Be careful. You're not gonna be able to wake them up. You're not gonna be able to wake them up. They're not dead. Okay. They're just living. But okay, you get what I'm saying. Okay.
So this person nods. Yes, we understand. And then he says something in this language to the other people around, and you feel yourself fading from consciousness again. You wake up sometime later in a room in a facility somewhere. You're in a bed. You're not restrained, but the sheets are, like, quite, like, tight around you. And the first thing that you see when your vision clears a little bit, the walls are this kind of, like, dull gray color. And directly across from you, there's like a big oil painting of a man in, like, long red robes holding like stone tablets. And in front of him, there's this, like, body of water that's, like, parting, and you can see in between them these little, like, this little caravan. And you see that just across the room. And then there's someone there beside you. Like, time is passing strangely for you. There's someone beside you, and they're injecting you with something, and your body isn't responding to what you want it to do. Like, you try to get up or move or say things, and you just kind of, like, garble what you're saying, and then fall back into sleep. Again, time passes. You wake up, and you're alone in that room. It's dark. You can just barely make out the painting on the wall across from you. There's an LED panel above you that's turned way down. It's like slightly like greenish light. You've got a bunch of like medical equipment attached to you, and you can hear like the faint pinging of a monitor. And when you come to, you realize you can't breathe. Maybe you start and there's like something in your mouth. What do you want to do?
Been there before too.
Yeah. Higgs kind of just opens one eye to make sure it's not a man standing in front of him.
There's nobody there, yeah. I mean, it's dark and you can see. You just like reach up and there's something like taped to your face.
Yeah.
Freak the fuck out and pull it out.
Yeah, I just freak it out and pull it out.
Okay. Yeah. All right, so yeah, you like gag and cough and like yank this plastic tube out of your throat and take like a big deep breath. And you can smell like antiseptic. Like it smells very like sterile in here.
Do I hear like a beep? Around.
Like yeah, you can still like you still have like you have an IV in and you have like some chest monitors and stuff monitoring your heartbeat. I don't know, have you ever woken up in the hospital before?
No, but I've watched enough sitcoms to understand what's about to happen. So I guess when I wake up, I basically just start like stripping everything off my arms. Am I in like a gown type deal?
Yeah, you're in a hospital gown.
Okay. I look around. Do I have a set of clothes near?
No, there's a chair nearby. There's a bedside table with a book on it. There's a locker on the other side of the room.
Yeah, I head towards the locker.
There's the painting in the door. Okay, make a physical effect save for me. Okay. See if you can stand.
13 out of 16.
Okay. All right, so you get out of bed and you fall. You yanks one of the monitors off and the machine starts beeping. What do you want to do? You have maybe a few minutes before, like, you want to reattach the machine? You want to try and crawl over to the locker?
I crawl over to the locker.
Okay. All right. So you get to the locker, and you pull it open, your clothes are, like, hanging on a hanger inside.
Do I see any weapons?
No, definitely not.
Do I see any identification, like a wallet or a compad or anything?
No, just your clothes. Like, you can't really, like, you can pull yourself up and kind of go through your pants and stuff, but you can't. Yeah, you just find the clothing that you had.
I look it up and down. You said there's a window in the room or there's not?
There's a viewport, yeah, on the side of the room. And from here, you can see, like, you turn and look at it, and you can see, like, a night scene of what looks like mountains in the distance. And it looks like it looks like you're in like maybe a village or something. There's a lot of like sort of like stone buildings and like a modern but built on an older sort of buildings. There's like roads and you can see a little like maybe a train in the distance in the mountains.
Do I see any type of computer in here that I could use as a compad?
No. There's a panel on the wall that just has like a button and then a cord running from it to the edge of the bed, like a nurse call button. But
okay. At this point, I kind of just look around and I just let out a long sigh and I'm just like, help! Please, someone come out of my room.
Okay, all right. So, yeah, I mean, they were on their way anyway. So, the door opens. There's a woman in just like a white, like hospital orderly, like outfit. And she comes in holding a data pad, and she kind of gasps when she sees that you're on the floor, and turns to leave, like to go get somebody.
No, wait, please don't.
Okay, so
don't
you, like, go. Reach out, yeah. Grab her. Okay, she turns and like looks at you, and she seems like scared of you, and tries to pull away, but you like grab her like dress, I guess. And she says something to you in that same language that they were speaking before, and like kind of holds her hand up, like don't freak out, don't hit me or don't grab me. Like she seems upset, but she's not like screaming. She's
I'm just like, do you speak? Can you understand me?
She shakes her head.
Is there... Can... Go... I just, like, wait for her to leave and go get someone else then.
Okay.
I understand. Right. Like, I know that she can't talk to me, so I just let her go.
Okay. All right. So she leaves. After a few minutes, she comes back, but she's hiding behind two men. There's a larger looking guy in an orderly's outfit, and he's holding like a white cloth, like something under his arm. And then there's another guy who's smaller. He's got glasses, and he's dressed like he's wearing like a lab coat, like a white lab coat, and he's got some kind of identification badge around his neck, and he's also holding like a data pad. And they're all speaking to each other in that language you don't understand. And then the doctor puts his hand out and says to you, "Please, what name? If someone picks up your phone, and it goes into like emergency mode or whatever. What identification information? Like, who do they think you are?"
They think that I am. Hold on.
He's ordering a pizza.
No, it's they. I put the name Nathan Benjamin Farmer.
Okay.
In my phone.
All right.
So for like an emergency name.
Okay. All right. So so the doctor says, "Please stay calm, Mr. Farmer. You were in a very bad crash. We are trying to take care of you."
He says that, and I'm like, "What? Oh, yes. My name is Nathan Farmer." I need to use that comm pad. It's so dire. I have to contact someone. Can I please use that?
He points to his friend, the big guy, and he's like, "Mr. Orenstein is going to pick you up and put you back in the bed. Please do not struggle. You're very badly hurt."
As he says that, I just go limp on the ground. Just like, wait.
Okay. So Orenstein picks you up and carries you over to the bed and like puts you back in it and says something to you again in a language you don't understand. And the doctor walks over and he says, "I understand you're very, very upset right now."
No, I'm not upset.
I want to assure you we're here to help.
Okay, I want to assure you I'm not upset. I would just
What like, is it that you need, Mr. Farmer?
I need to use your comm pad.
And he says, "You have to understand, I need to know why."
I have to contact a friend by the name of Pierre.
He says, is this friend of yours someone who lives on Elohaba?"
"Yes, I need to contact him and then..."
All right, please, relax. I will have the nurse bring you a communication device." And he turns and says something to her, and she leaves. The big guy is now standing at the door with his arms folded, just watching you kind of suspiciously. And the doctor says, "Please, I'm going to reattach the medical equipment. We need to..."
He's like, "I need to reattach your arm," and I'm like, "Ah!"
That's how it pans out. He's got all his limbs missing. He's like, "Ah!"
Yeah.
"We have to monitor your state to make sure that you don't get any worse. I assure you, all of this is for your own good.
Okay.
Please stay still." And he goes and like goes to start like reattaching things to you.
Okay, I'd let him. I don't fight it.
Okay. All right. So the nurse comes back and she has a like incredibly primitive communication device. Like it's basically like an iPhone.
A flip phone.
Yeah, like, well, maybe it's a little better than that. It probably has whatever passes with the internet on the show.
Motorola flip phone. No. Yeah.
She gives you her razor.
You've crash landed in the early 90s.
You have to take the whales back to the future.
So
have you done, you damn dirty apes?
Is it like a 9-pad phone or?
Yeah, it's like a local comms device.
Do I have okay? But would I know like the way to comms Pi?
Yeah, I don't know. Piani, does the Swan Song have like a local number for systems that are lower than tech level 4?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Yeah, I think it makes sense, right? Like you have a number that you can call. Sure, yeah. It's probably like a super complicated like string of digits, but you got it.
Yeah, so I call that.
Okay. All right. You get the local operator saying something to you in same language they've all been speaking. Like this kind of like boop beep beep.
I hang it up and try to dial again.
Okay.
Get the same thing. You do.
The doctor is like watching you. And he can understand what the person is saying. And he says to you, he's like, "Mr. Farmer, do you need assistance with something?"
It's not, why is it not working?
the number you are calling, the operator says it does not work.
I just fucking throw the phone across.
All right, so the big guy like starts to walk up to you like, whoa there, little guy, and the doctor puts his hand up. He's like, no, it's fine. I understand. Mr. Farmer's very upset. I will give you something to calm you down. And I don't need that.
I don't need that. I'm sorry.
And so he starts like adjusting the UV or the IV. UV just beaming you with light.
I'm sorry. Please don't. I don't need that. I need to start moving. Please, sir.
he says to you, no. You will not be going anywhere for some time. You have internal trauma. If there's anything that we can do to help, do you have family in the system? Someone I can reach out to.
The three people that were with me, that's my sister and my two brothers. Are they still here? Are they with us?